Good evening. Welcome. My name is Karen Nelson, and I'm Dean of the School of Architecture at the BAC. As you know, the BAC has been recognized with distinction for its leadership role in educating an extraordinarily diverse student body to help bring about social equity through design. Through the design of landscapes, of architecture, of interior architecture, of historic and sustainable spaces, of spaces for human health, we continue to be at the forefront of learning from practice and academic study with guidance from our brilliant instructors and celebrated practitioners. The approach to design practice and research that will be shared this evening is central to our mission, to be a place where everyone feels welcome to participate, to question, to learn, to be emboldened. Tonight, it's my pleasure to introduce the BAC's final event in the student sponsored lecture series of fall 2019. As you may be aware, the BAC live streams all of its lectures on the BAC Facebook page, so if you can't make it for the future, please tune in. The Maurice F. Childs Endowed Lectureship was established at the BAC in 2008 to honor the memory of Maurice Childs, a dedicated preservationist and celebrated architect who was a co-founder of the Boston-based architectural firm Childs, Bertram, and Sikkaris. The BAC and CBT have long held professional and personal history together. CBT co-founders Maurice Childs, Richard Bertman, Charles Sikkaris all have taught at the BAC and have many other firm employees, and CBT employs several BAC students and alumni among them. The Childs Endowed Lectureship was created to honor Maury Child's commitment to design education and his lifelong contributions to the BAC and its students in perpetuity. Tonight's lecturer, Craig Scott, is the fourth to have this honor. Let me first tell you a little bit about Craig. He received his Associate of Science degree in Architectural Engineering at the University of Nevada, a Bachelor of Architecture from Syracuse University, and his Master of Architecture degree with distinction from Harvard University's Graduate School of Design. He has previously worked at Brian Healy Associates in Boston, at Roto Architects in LA, and at Morphosis, among other storied firms. Currently, he's professor of architecture at California College of the Arts in San Francisco, where he focuses on advanced and core studios, as well as architectural analysis. He's taught previously at Michigan, Harvard, Syracuse, Sydney, SIAR, Yale, and he began at the BAC. Now about his firm. Iwamoto Scott is an award-winning and internationally recognized architecture practice established in San Francisco by Lisa Iwamoto and Craig Scott in 2002. Iwamoto Scott has won more than 80 design awards and honors. Most recently, the firm received the Cooper Hewitt's National Design Award in Interior Architecture for 2019. This award recognizes excellence nationally. Iwamoto Scott creates innovative design at all scales, from art installations and interiors to buildings and visionary cities. The firm has been at the forefront of digital fabrication, design computation, and materials, and they use this experience to contribute fresh ideas to each project. Their work has been published in hundreds of journals and exhibited in over 50 museums and galleries, including at the MoMA, the Guggenheim, SFA MoMA, and Vitra, among others. I think that you will see that their work is compact. It has a quality of being sculptural and in tension with itself and its site. Even imagined networks in visionary cities have an intensity and layered compactness to them. When I asked Craig to tell me more about tonight's lecture title, Three Avenues, he described the work trajectories that Iwamoto Scott pursues: experimental, speculative, and more typical design inspired by both of those paths. Please extend a warm welcome to Craig Scott.
Turn my own phone. So thank you, Karen. Thank you to the BAC and to CBT for inviting me for the Childs Memorial Lecture. And thanks to also to Dean Nelson, of course, but Chair Rich Griswold. We were classmates in grad school, so it's a nice reconnection. I missed the 25th, amazingly, it's been 25 years, but 25th anniversary of our graduation, and he happened to go a few weeks ago, but at least I'm back in Boston, if not at that event, here at this event. So it's great to be here. And with that, I'm gonna get started. So as Karen mentioned, there are these two ends of the spectrum that of a kind of scalar and conceptual spectrum to our work. And the labels dropped out because we had a last minute font thing glitch with translating this to a PDF. But what those three areas are in, on the left, fabrications and installation, on the right, speculations, and in the middle is the built work, which includes buildings and interiors we've completed recently. So to start, to speak a bit about the small scale, one-to-one scale end of that spectrum, the installation and fabrication projects, we've been influenced by certain things, including art practice and even just everyday vernacular forms and structures. So at the top, those four images are some kind of touchstone projects of ours that we've come across over the years, or for us that we've come across. A piece by Ava Hess, another by Anthony Gormley, installation by Tara Donovan, and then on the right is a kind of roadside improvised hay bale covering of using tires as weights. And what one of the things that unites all these is this kind of particular kind of accumulation and porosity and kind of interstitial space that results from that, but it, ultimately that there's a kind of defamiliarization in each case of the material that's used. And we seek to pursue that in our work, which the bottom two rows show some close-ups of various installations over the years. So I'm just gonna talk about a couple. One is Fussoir Cloud, which was a piece done around 10 years ago at the SciArt Gallery in Los Angeles, part of their series of invited installations. And we took the opportunity to explore both the material that we were interested in, micro-engineered wood laminate, and a kind of structural topology. So we started with the module scale itself, and were inspired by investigations in computational origami, where folds can occur not only along straight edges, but also along curved edges. And wood, this micro-engineered wood, its properties of directionality due to the grain had some interesting kind of dialogue with when we brought to bear the geometries of this computational origami to it. So the piece is made up of 1,300 individually shaped modules guided by a kind of optimized minimal surface form, which was aided by our collaboration with Bureau Happold out there at Los Angeles office, where we used virtual hanging chain models and software to optimize the form of this and to bring our kind of vision together with the structural optimization that they provided. And our initial studies of this vaulted form, which we thought of as an immersive kind of space, not an object in the gallery, but a piece that would fill the entire space and have a different kind of experience than some of the other installations that had gone on here. But that the form finding that we did with our own computers and the structural optimization that Bureau Happel did surprisingly came very close. And when we overlaid those two models, we were quite similar in the ultimate form. And it plays out with a kind of gradation of density and porosity based on the stresses in these faulted surfaces. The thing we're interested in as well is this play on a traditional structural piece of voussoirs, you know, a wedge-shaped part of an arch which distributes the load, a compressive form that's, you know, has a long legacy in architectural structure. And we thought about taking an element like that and transforming it and using, in the end, a very lightweight material to suggest the weightiness and the substance of a traditional voussoir. So as the light changes in the gallery, there's a clerestory window, so it allowed for light to pass through at times, but the thinness of the material also allowed for a kind of unexpected translucency that would come about at different times of day or different mixtures of the artificial light and the natural light in the gallery. So it offered this kind of defamiliarization in the experience that we are interested in and some of the work that I showed, where you, as you first walked in the gallery, it seemed like these weighty wood blocks in a compressive arrangement, but you came to discover that it's this kind of paper thin folded surface. More recent, what we think of an installation, but at building scale, was our contribution to the City View Garage in the Miami Design District. The site is right along the freeway at the edge of the district, so it has the potential to be a kind of landmark and a gateway announcing the presence of the design district at the scale of the freeway. It's also one of three pieces at the other end of the garage, is an installation by Leon Leong, architects out of New York, and then in the center is a piece by John Baldessari, the LA-based artist. So we are each given a kind of third of the garage. Our third happened to wrap around and includes an egress stair and a small office tower facade as part of the design. This is a shot during construction. So one thing we were interested in was creating something that worked as a kind of continuous fabric in a sense, and also responded to these dramatic skies that you find in Miami. And so we developed this module, which in terms of geometry, it negotiates between a six-sided figure at the perimeter of each module, made up of two halves, actually, in terms of how it was assembled, between a six-sided figure and a four-sided aperture in the middle. So this diamond-shaped void in the center of this hexagonal piece. So this shows the array, and there are five different permutations of that module in terms of the size of the apertures. And then another interest we had was often these lightweight garage skins or scrims have a solution where there's continuous substructure, like vertical girts or struts that the skin would attach to. And given the budget, we knew we couldn't depart too much from that basic approach. But we also, as we evolved this honeycomb logic or overall organization of the array, we knew we didn't want to have weaken the effect of this continuous fabric-like surface. And as well, at night, we knew that would, you know, also compromise the expression. So we came up with this set of stanchions that cantilevered down from the slab above and up from the slab below, and these kind of partial struts, and the skin, the metal modules themselves, how they're attached and how they attach to each other, form a structural skin that's able to span that gap. And it also has to contend with hurricane force winds given its location in Miami. So it was great to arrive at this solution working with Zahner Metals to be able to pull it off. They did full-scale prototypes in their yard in Kansas City. And there's this five-color modulation that goes together with the five aperture sizes. And one thing that happens, I mean, in addition to the variability of the reading of those modules based on how bright it is outside or the changing skies, there's this other aspect of the project that learned along the way that it would become kind of a backdrop to this space across the street, which is called Jungle Plaza. And it's where different events happen, changing events that are sponsored by the design district, including Design Miami. So this is a shot from a case of having these 3D printed pavilions by shop architects, which were over in Miami Beach or originally across the water. And the Art Basel Miami, Design Miami kind of event, and they moved them over to the plaza. So it was this kind of interesting fortuitous dialogue between these 3D printed pavilions and a facade, which again, the faceting and the coloration, the outcome is that, and we didn't actually sadly ever go and get this thing professionally photographed. We still have yet to, we keep talking about like, let's finally hire a photographer. But many people have shot it. It was, I mean, in this Instagram age, it has a lot of various images that have showed up of it. And it's amazing to see how it transforms across the changing seasons and especially the changing skies, which are so dramatic in Miami. In the span of one day, the skies can really do different things, and those facets really kind of capture that. So this was a more recent, a very recent, just this fall it was finished, variation on the theme of a lightweight skin, again in aluminum, and it was the result of an invited design competition that we won last summer and spent the following year seeing it through. It's at UCSF on the Mission Bay campus, and that was a rendering of the project that was produced for the competition. This is to locate it. It's positioned directly across from the new Chase Center, home of the NBA Warriors, that just opened simultaneously as this was finished. That was opening a couple months ago. And so this being affiliated with UCSF, a big part of the research that goes on there, it has to do with life sciences and pretty high-tech investigation into genetics and DNA. And so we discovered a body of research which was called cellular origami, and we started to give the project that name, being inspired by it, which is a process of kind of reconstructing DNA. And so it at the risk of the cliche, like there are many projects that I think by now have been inspired by the double helix form of DNA and the structure. And what we tried to do in our case was kind of re-present it as these flattened shapes that got reinterpreted and simplified, and then kind of re-three-dimensionalized through this simple butterfly shape of these two folded faces. And so in this case, we did resort to continuous vertical substructure as a way to support this, but came up with a system that works with that rather than you know, having to invent a new structure, which we didn't really have the budget to do in this instance, but to work with a kind of a known functional approach like that. And so there are these variations on the shapes and their degree of bend, a total of 944 panels shown there. And this is a full-scale mock-up in front of our office, which is not far actually from that site. It's just about a quarter mile from there. So it's handy, you know, to be that close, obviously, to think about it and visit it as often as we like. This is a couple of images of it recently. We also haven't, these are my own shots, actually. We haven't, this one being as new as it is, gotten it professionally shot, but it's in a position to have this interesting dialogue with some recent things around it, the arena, as I just mentioned, and the new Uber HQ by, again, shop architects, coincidentally. It's a complete coincidence, but they're across the street. And this new Muni T-line subway stop, and, or sorry, streetcar stop in front of the skin. This is a close-up which shows that varying set of folded pedals, as we call them, and they're all anodized aluminum in this. And lo and behold, that this happens to be by shop as well. It's called the Gateway, and it's part of the development that the Warriors partnered on. They didn't just build an arena, they built two office blocks, and then this Gateway was something that developers commissioned from. We were also working with them on Uber HQ on the next block, Caddy Corner. So this is a view from that Chase Center Plaza. That Gateway forms a kind of bleacher stair toward facing the arena, and our screen becomes a backdrop. And then during events, it really becomes a backdrop because they use this space for like pre-game and after-game press coverage, but also other events. This is Steph Curry there before his unfortunate breaking of his hand at the beginning of the season, which has not bode well for their playing, their performance this season. But anyway, that's him with an event focused on women, young women athletes, and he's being photographed with that as a backdrop. So there's the other end of the spectrum are these, as we call them, speculations. They are a range of projects we've been fortunate to have taken part in, often future facing, looking towards the future. Some have been for museum exhibitions, others for vision studies, and some of that work has led into actual commission work. So at the top are some earlier projects from that beginning phase of these speculative proposals, so the Jellyfish House, Edward Street Towers at the tip of Manhattan, and then the City of the Future in the middle, Talon Hydro Line at the far right in the middle, and a commission project that I can speak a little bit about. It went on for a while, this project, in our office and in collaboration with the people we shared space with for a number of years in the Dogpatch area of San Francisco, where our office is located. They're called Obscura Digital, an immersive and interactive media agency. We partnered on this. And it was for a large tech company, and with the premise of something like a Burning Man, a new version of Burning Man specifically for, it's interesting because I think of that audience or constituency as being made up already of a lot of tech types, I'm sure, more and more these days, mixed with artists and a lot of other people, are pretty heterogeneous. So the idea was, what if there could be a kind of temporary or ephemeral gathering like this that would allow the tech employees to kind of remove themselves from their everyday world and be a place apart to think about new ideas. Like Burning Man, which has a big order, this big radial pattern, and this, within that, it allows a kind of bottom-up improvisational inhabitation. We researched a number of other precedents, this from the original instant city of Archigram to these impromptu or informal improvisational gatherings and kind of camping, motorhome arrangements, and so on, and thought about how these two can come together, the bigger top-down order with the dynamism of this bottom-up kind of unexpected way that it's inhabited. So this was an early study of using a binary code to kind of think the brand of the company as a way to, as a larger kind of gesture, and how that would set up these zones and neighborhoods of different types of program and avenues or these bands of event spaces cutting across a cross grain of different habitation bands. And within those habitation, each one would have these varying densities and mixtures of different kinds of temporary housing, from small tents, medium, to like glamping, or luxurious tents to motorhomes. And they could cluster within these districts. And the whole thing we also thought of as adaptable and deformable to varying site conditions, and kind of tested it out on different sites. So this was an overview of it with this kind of main event strip cutting across on the diagonal, and then how at night these different communal spaces and venues would start to come alive in another way, along with the tent city itself, and really create this sense of a kind of other place, almost a surreal, this place apart. So it was thought of originally as being very removed from the city. But then we tested it in different situations, like maybe it wouldn't have to go so far out. It might be like in an agrarian setting like this. This is the large central valley in California. Or maybe it could actually be right in the midst of the city in a place that is not really in people's consciousness. So this is the Alameda Naval Air Station, which is an unused, huge swath of vacant land right in the middle of the Bay Area. So another instance, I don't think this is fully, some of these projects cross over from the different categories, from installation to speculation to built commissioned work. And this one, starts with the thinking at scale of those speculations, but is a commission for a whole city block in San Francisco, an area known as the Florida District. And this former use on the site was a commercial flower growing operation. So it has these dilapidated greenhouses that populate the site currently. And of course, with the housing crunch, it's statewide and especially present in the Bay Area. We're the new owner of this land, and we are both interested in density, but a density that can kind of live with the surrounding fabric. So we explored different ways of bringing the car, the pedestrian, and a denser, but still low-rise pattern of living on this block. So another interest that the client actually brought to the table that we were really excited about is this idea of incremental housing, that the houses would, be a certain size when they're sold, and that they could be added on to with pre-approved additions and grow in a somewhat unpredictable manner, but also somewhat predictable somewhere in between those two states. But and so the, you know, well-known examples in Chile as it's played out, we are de-densifying from the original scheme, but still quite more dense than a typical block of single family houses and the same size block right across from us. There's basically this two typologies, flats and carriage house kind of solution, where there's a house behind a house and a kind of mews and commons down the center of the block. And this is an image of its more dense state. We're now about a third less dense than this. A neighboring block over to the right there has 36 single family houses, and we're proposing 63 residences, so almost doubling. At one point we were higher, we were closer to up around 83, but it's such a kind of touchy process forward with between the planning department and the community group in the process of kind of sorting this one out. So the last category of commissioned buildings and interiors, there's a series of images here across the top, which are again spanning, in this case, from art practice to architects, the work of architects that we appreciate and are inspired by. And there's been a constant kind of thread through of investigation of both strategizing the relationship between negative space and positive form, and certain geometric preoccupations, along with, of course, accommodating the given program. But those are some drivers of the work as it's proceeded. So in San Francisco, a lot of the opportunities are in interiors by nature. It's so largely built out. We're starting recently to get more into exterior full buildings and so on, but a lot of our first built work at this larger scale were interiors. And so we're fortunate to have worked with Pinterest on several occasions now. This being a headquarters about 100,000 square feet within an existing warehouse, four-story mushroom column concrete frame, renovated in the 80s originally with a small atrium in the center. But that atrium stopped at the second floor. So the first floor was very dark in the middle. So our strategy was to cut, kind of core that atrium down one floor to the ground floor and create this center to the space, and then insert this sculptural communication stair within that new found daylit void. And so the other program around that center at the ground floor is the reception and lobby and all hands and dining space that wraps around, and then the servery and some training rooms and interview rooms towards them. And above that whole first floor, along the initial structural or the first bay in from the street, is this thing, this diagrid plywood ceiling, which we thought of as a kind of super threshold between company and city. This is an instance where there's a quite transparent relationship between, you know, the tech company and the public space of the city. They're often quite introverted and inward focused and not really having a lot of interface with public space. So here there's a first opportunity. We got to pursue that even more so later headquarters. But the space with this idea of the super threshold and these more communal boxes along the front has led to it being used, like, for instance, this last weekend, SF made their event here where there's 38 local makers displaying all their crafts and goods, and the public is invited in for this yearly event. So it's really played out as a way that, you know, there can be this overlap in the base of the creative tech company, space of the city. And the company was, you know, it was and is growing this whole time. And at this point, there was an intention to really use humble materials but in innovative ways, to not like leave behind where they had come from, which is a much smaller headquarters right down the block, about a quarter of the size. So plywood played largely in the design in both custom mobile furniture, the hybrid ceiling, as well as other surfaces throughout. But then at the center is this stair, which we came to name a knitting stair, which I'll describe. But it's this communication stair between the first floor and the second, and then there's a smaller version, in a sense, of the same materiality of this perforated white metal that makes its way up to the upper floors that's detached from this. But it becomes both this node and condenser, you know, every day, two or three times a day for the meals that the company has and or events and all hands meetings, are the stair gets packed with people kind of funneling from the upper levels. It also acts as a kind of lantern and, you know, a filter of the daylight that comes from the skylight above, as well as a source of LED integrated lighting within its double perforated walls. And so you move around it to go to the servery and the different food stations, snack and beverage area, and there's a IT help lounge in the distance there. There are these couple of large apertures facing different directions that cut through the perforated skin. And the stair is partially suspended from the second floor and structurally kind of anchored at the bottom. It was this balance of having this kind of double structural solution of like a cantilever off the floor and a suspension of the landing. That's during lunch. Okay. So knitting is a big part of the Pinterest community and ethos. They talk about it and do it. They have these, you know, knit bombs, or like where they have like knit, they have a conference called KnitCon. But this idea of like internal knitting between employees and this social knitting and actual like making of stuff and craft all folded together. So we thought of the knitting needles being an analog for this stair, which has a volume that kind of intersects itself as it switches back. And so at the heart of the stair is this aperture that's the product of those two flights intersecting each other, and it gives this glimpse through the stair of, you know, the other flight going up or down. So this sense of kind of the knitting of movement is the result. And that's an overview of the organization, where the formal and informal meeting spaces all form this kind of porous zone wrapped around that central stair. And then at the perimeter bay is where the workstations all get situated to take advantage of being closer to the daylight. And so between that central atrium and the stair and the outer workstation zone are varying degrees of porosity. That's a meeting room. These are, that one being a more formal meeting room, this set of informal meeting spaces starts kind of carving away at the more enclosed meeting spaces, and they interact through these different glass services, and we got to play with this idea of a glass corner that reappears multiple times throughout these floor plates. It allows you to have these diagonal glimpses through that forest zone, and also allows some daylight to get borrowed through at the same time. But so there's this interaction that this allows for that you don't, you know, typically get in these enclosed meeting room scenarios, in contrast to the open office bank surrounding it, where you get these glimpses right through that fairly dense inner zone. And also, like, unexpected adjacencies are revealed through these corner apertures between different kinds of uses. There's not a lot of ping pong going on there. It's a lot more meeting than leisure stuff, but there's a couple of things mixed in to that world. And so we a next project for them was smaller and quicker, but equally fun to be part of and really interesting, in that there was this coincidence that across the street from this office space on Fifth Avenue, New York, is the main branch of the New York Public Library, which houses this incredible scissor stair towards the back of the library. It has its grand stair a lot like the Boston Public Library at the front, but then it has this scissor stair towards the back. And we've always been fascinated by this idea of a scissor stair, because it, you know, when it's like in the form of escalators that just crisscross, they are, or it's more like two ships passing in the night, you know, you're on your own kind of trajectory. But when it has a shared landing like this as a stair, and you can go up or down any of these four different start points, then it's much more interesting as a kind of mixing chamber, a kind of crossing of paths, and offering a set of choices of which way you move up or down it. So we reinterpreted that in our case in this central bay. When you first come off the elevator lobby, there's this crisscrossing of our version of the scissor stair. But in this case, we want to make it very transparent with the windows on Fifth Ave beyond, to not be blocking the daylight from the reception space. So we came up with these suspension plates, steel plates that become the steel risers of the stair, and then they're actually wrapped in wood, and then additional wood ones are added in to kind of blend the structural supports with this other idea of a surface that we're, you know, describing through this contoured set of wood slats. And so there's a different kind of transparency as you move around it. It becomes very almost opaque seeming. Has this strong sense of being, having almost like a carved interior, depending on your vantage point, where at other times you see, you know, right through it. So the more recent HQ2 for Pinterest in San Francisco is right down the same street. Luckily for them, they've managed to secure spaces within blocks to allow employees to just walk or grab a scooter, but, you know, get back and forth between their buildings quite easily, and have a sense of a kind of urban campus in the end. It's not, you know, divorced from the city and sealed off from the public realm, but pretty much embedded and immersed in public realm. So this is a new building going up at the same time as our design for the interior was happening. And it's the double height lobby in this case is what's known as a POPO, so privately owned public open space, and is adjacent to a mid-block alley that cuts through the block. So because it's a POPO, so in this case it's officially kind of public space. And so you get a lot of great interaction, even more so than previous headquarters. And that's aided by the fact that Pinterest decided to open their a cafe in that space, and they run it themselves. It's called The Point, and it's kind of more curated, I guess, because of that, and has interesting connections with between the company and this, you know, average service for the city. This overlap is strengthened by that. And then, so in this case, the stair that we proposed is a cascading stair. It's a more linear building, and the idea is to slice through the middle with this. It starts at the bottom as a switchback, and then it switches back once more, which is that sculptural piece hanging over the post lobby. And then from there, for four floors, it cuts through the center as a spine through the building. So this is where it switches back at the ground floor. And there's a passage parallel to the mid-block alley, which is a circulation route past a training room and a library space and a second lobby at the other end and some lounge. We got to do one of our installations again. There have been a few projects where we had the opportunity to do like a project within the project. So here, this ceiling, fabric ceiling installation is designed. And in this case, didn't build it. Like in the olden days, we would have built this helps too, but we are not finding the time or space to do that as much anymore. So we mocked it up full scale, and that served as a great guide for a contractor to build it. It's made out of this non-woven mesh material, which we've used in a few different instances. This is towards the back of that spine, the library on the right, and a gallery of users on the left. And then at the second level, where the stair switches, it lands after that first switchback and brings you to the dining and all hands space and the kind of IT help lounge in the back there. Then the stair switches back again, hanging over that lobby as you saw before. Here we got to work with the builder to achieve these custom LED fixtures that get kind of neatly fit into a custom acoustic ceiling. This building's all raised floor, access floor for HVAC, and most of the power there as well. That's that moment overlooking the Propos lobby. And as you switch back there, going to the next level, and from there on, it cuts through all upper four levels. And at each landing, there's a different mix of micro kitchen or lounge or informal meeting space. And there's a similar arrangement with that kind of bank of porous wrapping zone around the central stair as the other headquarters, where there's a mix of informal and formal meeting spaces and communal space mixed in. And then the perimeter again has all the workstations. So here the stair is defined by these light aluminum rods and these lofted surfaces where this, as the stair is cutting through, it emerges as a different shaped three-dimensional object at each level. And becomes, it doesn't have the integrated lighting of that other stair I showed, but it does have this interesting effect of the lighting that's around it creates these amazing kind of shadow arrays that are kind of changing at different levels as the light passes through those rods. And the rods themselves act as the guardrails, so we didn't have to. But we still needed the handrails, the black element there, but at least it didn't need like the full guardrail each floor aperture, because these kind of bells of aluminum rods were designed to code to act also as guardrails. So here you can see the different program on the sides of one. This is the top one. And then looking back down where it cuts right through, and you can actually see cars on the street passing by through the glass wall of the provost at the end of it. So you get this connection back to the city always. And this stair has really become a favorite route of employees. Like, hardly anyone takes the elevator. It's really encouraged movement on foot through the six-story building, which was the idea. It's like a vertical or a diagonal street through. On a smaller scale, this one's starting to move into the outside realm. It's for Tishman's Fire, a lobby, a plaza redesign, and a canopy, more in the downtown area of San Francisco. And so there's a building which had a pretty unsightly collection of storefront and entrances on the street. And the idea was to kind of organize those and with a dark meaning of that surface and bring this new, to reposition the building essentially through the redesign of the lobby with this new welcoming canopy. And then that was the state of the lobby of 1980s, very kind of constrained, almost oppressive feeling, you know, kind of narrow, dark, complicated feeling lobby. And so this is the new space. We basically, rather than tear out all this pink granite and send it to a landfill, and just the effort to do that and the carbon footprint, we just left it there and kind of reclad the surfaces with this simple white drywall and these inserted wood subtractive wedges, and a white ceiling that makes its way through and angles kind of differently depending which way you're coming or going. The facets tilt in different directions with any way. I'm getting towards the end projects here. This two single family houses, this is one in Noe Valley where we're playing on the bay window condition or context of San Francisco and tilting this middle volume towards the downhill views, and in doing that, fitting within the legal bay window footprint, which is pretty strongly dictated by the planning department, but forming a kind of contemporary expression at the same time. And then at the heart of this house is a stair that makes its way to the roof with the skylight. There has another form of integrated lighting, this kind of strip of LED open visors that allow the daylight to filter down. This house was completed as a second home in Napa County. It's called Godot House on a rugged 95-acre parcel. And it's a really compelling site with wraparound views in all directions, none of which are bad. The one towards the lake is kind of a privileged view, but the views in all directions are pretty spectacular. So we resisted the urge and the client's original thought of making like a glass box or something just really transparent and fully looking out in all directions, and came up with this idea of a form that is both kind of extroverted and oriented outward and introverted at the same time to this central diamond-shaped courtyard. And the form is kind of created by taking these four program zones, the living dining, kitchen block, master bedroom block, kids bedroom block, and guest room yoga block, and arraying those simple rectangular blocks around this six-sided figure. And this is another instance where there's a negotiation between the geometry of six-sided figure. In case the roofs all slope inward to that central court, and this mat slab, which we used as a structural solution to unstable soils, tilts up at its edges to get the house to kind of levitate slightly and lift above the ground. That also serves as a fire safety measure. So there's this tension between this kind of autonomous object, it almost like the spaceship landed there, and a very site-specific object because the way it's manipulated and carved and posed feels very much, you know, of the site. When you first come in, it's this diamond-shaped courtyard that you encounter, and you can move around that with a hallway reaching the four different program blocks, but you start also to have these different reflections of the lake behind you, kind of conflating with the view of the small Zen garden in the center. And a really kind of dynamic shift of from acute to obtuse angles as you move around. There are these four wedge-shaped covered decks that orient out to the landscape as kind of reverse force perspectives in different directions that start to pull that landscape back into the house visually. And then the whole corner facing the lake opens up with this stacking sliding door system, fairly minimal kitchen, and lighting is integrated into the panelized ceiling, a different kind of light integrated around the hallway wrapping the void. And then, I mean, this is very quick. This is about to break ground in LA. We're doing a number of multifamily projects these days. This will be the first standalone. You know, we're doing the exterior and the interior. Some of the others we're doing just the interior, or just the exterior, but in this case, the whole project. It's on Santa Monica Boulevard next to a historic public library, the second oldest in LA. So there's this issue of, you know, the relationship of this building to that, the dialogue between them, and the performance of being this slightly stepped, kind of pixelated set of modules. And those colors indicate the different unit types. And then this is a diagram of how, through a strategy of light wells and small horizontal connective decks that cut through to connect to those light wells, we're able to get a quite dense building on a small lot. This is 16 units. And I'm finishing here with some of the largest work we're involved with. This nearly a million square foot project, which has gotten final approvals and should start construction next year. 88 Bloxham in the Soma district. It's on a site that currently holds 24 tennis courts, 12 indoors and 12 up on the roof. A kind of bunker of a building, you know, very anti-pedestrian feeling and pretty much opaque at the street level. But there was a negotiation between the club and the developer to rehouse 12 of those tennis courts in the project. So it's a kind of crazy mix of 12 tennis courts, a couple of large commercial buildings, a zone of parking that's in the trusses spanning the courts, at just underground one level, and then affordable housing project across the mid-block alley with the public rec center and swimming pool bottom of that next to the tennis courts. So a pretty complex thing in terms of zoning. And with these larger projects, I should say, we work with an executive architect. Our office is, you know, 16 staff, and Lisa and I. And at this scale, it would be really hard to take them out. And so the larger interiors projects and this with partner with an executive architect. This is some of the complex zoning response to achieve this massing. We're working with surface design landscape architects on the site. They're doing a linear park down the whole street and amid the mid-block alley, as well as inhabited decks. These are some professional renderings, you know, commissioned for the project along the linear park and looking into this gap between the buildings, kind of glassy connector. We were interested in breaking the massing down into these two kind of like family members, you know, related but different in terms of their expression. And so these are some diagrams along way of how we arrived at the skin systems for both buildings. For the taller tower, it was this diagonal projection mapping that produced a gradient of different aperture sizes. And then for the other building, it's like these kind of gradient of sliding vertical terracotta panels. And those are some of the diagrams of the different modules, which we're right now involved in refining and value engineering. Then there's also an idea that the communication stair could come back into play. It so happens, meanwhile, Pinterest has leased the whole taller building, 500,000 square feet almost. And so we'll luckily get to work with them again for the largest project to date. And it happens to be on the same street that their other buildings have all been on. So it's a really fortuitous set of circumstances. So they're, you know, these are just initial studies of how in this taller building communication to be on the next round of those. And this is the last project I'm gonna go really quick. This is close to our office and quite near that garage. Actually, there's a little map here just to situate some of the stuff. The garage near the Warriors Arena is over there, the cellular origami. Our office is right here. The Pinterest projects in that large development, 88 blocks in right there. And where I teach, CCA is right here, which is, oh, I was hitting the middle, sorry. Which is having its expansion go on now with Genie Gang, Studio Gang underway apparently. And then some of the things around here, the Airbnb HQ, Box HQ, it's pretty intensive with this kind of tech world that's come about in the last few years. So this project is the last in a row of buildings and will be along open space and the freeway that comes in from the south into San Francisco. These are some diagrams of the evolution of the form. It's kind of a pie-shaped site and quite constrained by that, obviously, but we're interested in having this building with these a few moves or inflections in the massing help to mark the kind of ending of the row of these lab and office buildings along the freeway, and then to have its own presence on this open public space adjacent to the building. And there's some, you know, semi-public program conference center in the base and life sciences labs above. But the terracing for the conference centers is designed to kind of interface with the public space next to it. And from this angle, the idea is to create this kind of marker for just before that 280 freeway kind of rises up and lands into the Selma district beyond. And the facade is evolving along a somewhat similar line as the other building, but a pretty different system. In this case, have aluminum fins for sun shading and a series of recesses that are combined with the fins. So the facade has this kind of push and pull with the limited set of modules that we mix up to achieve this kind of gradient wrap around the whole thing. And with that, I'm done. Thank you.